Hey everyone, Cleo here, and today I'm talking about the books that I read in the month of April. As always, I will have a couple of numbers on the screen. If you want more information on those, I would suggest you check out my 2021 reading goals video or the very first one of these wrap-ups that I did in January, because I go into those a little bit more within that video. But so the numbers on the screen will be the physical TBR at the beginning of this month. This was down to 72 books. The amount of credits in my book buying credit system at the beginning of the month, I had 20 credits to spend. And then the third one will be the amount of books that I read within the month. So it'll be climbing as we go through this video. So first up, let me quickly mention the books that I've already talked about in my April mid-month check-in. So these books I won't dive into too much within this video. And so if you want my thoughts on these, you can go and check out my April mid-month check-in. So first up, The Trader Queen by Trudy Canavan. This is a book off of my TBR, so I get one credit for it. The Art of Patience, Searching for Snow Leopards in Tibet by Sylvain Tesson. This was a newly purchased book, so I get two credits for it. In this case, actually DNF'd it, sadly. And then the final one for that video is The Memory of Souls by Jen Lyons. This, at the time in which I read it, I did not own physically, and so it did not cost me any credits, but I also don't get any credits for having finished it, so you won't see any changes in the numbers up there. But so, second half of the month. Before I dive into what I read in the second half of the month, I'm going to quickly mention the book that I purchased in the meantime, and that would be Tokyo Ueno Station by Yu Miri. This is a book translated from Japanese by Morgan Giles. It is by Tilted Access Press. I have recently purchased a subscription to Tilted Access Press, meaning that whenever they are going to come out with new books within this year, I will be getting them sent automatically to me. So I am very much looking forward to reading more of their published works, because they are a publisher who are specialized in publishing Asian works in translation. So very much looking forward to that. If you followed me on this channel, you know that I love Asian literature. And so I'm very much looking forward to reading more of those works. But so Tokyo Ueno Station is a book that I put on my May TBR, so it shouldn't be sticking around on my physical TBR for too long. It cost me 12 euros, so this is worth 4 credits, so 4 credits taking away from my book buying credit system at this point in time. Alright, so let's dive into the books that I finished. First up, one that I already talked about quite extensively within my April mid-month check-in, because I was very close to finishing at that point, is Master of Sorrows by Justin Call. So Justin T. Call, depending on whether you have the US edition or the UK edition. I absolutely love this one. You can see I heavily tabbed it, and I will be making a video specifically about the disability representation within this one, because this is a fantasy book with a disabled protagonist. So disability is a topic that is near and dear to my heart, and I do want to bring out some videos about disability representation within fantasy. They are coming. I keep on teasing these videos, but I need to refilm it once again, because the second take is of such bad filming quality that I just need to retake it. It'll come one day these videos will come. But so, in this book we follow our protagonist Anef. Anef is born with just one hand, and the pure fact of him having a disability is immediately enough for people to want to kill him, because their mythology has a sort of fallen god who lost a hand, and so everybody who is disabled or who suffers some sort of an injury is immediately treated suspiciously, immediately treated as if they are sort of like descendant of that god, as if this god has marked them as being loyal to him. Anef is saved by the local priest, and throughout his childhood he is hiding his disability through the use of a mobility aid. That alone already really warms my heart. I really love the representation for mobility aids within this one, and the way in which we get a sort of fantastical version of mobility aids. I really love that sort of aspect to it, the way of integrating the fantastical with disability without resorting to some of the more traditional ways in which disability and fantasy have kind of been blended in the past. This book is going to talk a lot about ableism, as you can tell from that sort of like setup of the story, but it's definitely not the case that that is sort of like its main focus neither. I have read so many reviews of people reading this book who don't even dive into disability representation, because the story is just fun and great on its own. The author took 15 years before writing this book to develop the story, to plot out the story as a whole, and he has material for 12 books in total, apparently. So we are in for the long run. There's a lot more to come when it comes with this world, and so I'm very much looking forward to it. Because this whole story is kind of set in a hidden town within this world. This town hosts a big academy, And if by a certain age they haven't been able to pass the sort of test of admittance, then they are banned from the academy and need to take on more sort of like stewardship roles. So the story kind of sets out in the way of a sort of like magic school setting, even though magic is actually kind of banned within this world. It does kind of feel similar to a magic school setting, and it has a lot of that sort of like tropes and storylines, but the story definitely also takes a turn somewhere like around the midway point of this book, and there's so much packed into this book, but it definitely is a great ride. I absolutely loved it. It sat on my shelves for 2 years without me reading it, and now I cannot wait for the sequel. Luckily, because it sat on my shelves for 2 whole years, I only have to wait, like I only had to wait like 3/4 of a month or something, because on the 6th of May, in the UK version at least, this sequel is getting published. So hopefully I'll get access to it pretty soon. I pre-ordered it, but you never know with, you know, the shipping times and Brexit and things like that. So hopefully it's going to be available to me soon. Next, let's dive into a few disappointing reads, shall we? So first up, we have Juliet Naked by Nick Hornby. So this is a adult contemporary. In this one, we're following a couple. I don't think they're actually married, but they are living together. They've been together for a very long time. However, it doesn't really seem like they have much of a romantic attachment to one another. And at the sort of beginning of the story, the status quo of their relationship gets disrupted, because the husband of this couple is very much a die-hard fan of a musician who hasn't really produced any new work in the past 15 years. However, at the beginning of this book, he comes out, or a new demo album of his is released with sort of like the uncut or the raw versions of some of his earlier songs. And our two protagonists have very differing opinions about the quality of that demo album. And that kind of puts a wrench in their relationship and kind of makes them drift apart from one another. However, I do feel like towards the latter half of the story, we are very much zooming in on one of these two characters, and we're kind of leaving the other one behind. We do get back to the other character, and we do see the other character and their development a little bit, but not to the extent that we do with the other characters. So I kind of felt like we started off this story with two protagonists, and then we kind of abandon one midway, and maybe even push in a third one later on within the book. And so structurally, I felt like that didn't really fully work. Like, that was a little bit of a weakness in my opinion. But the biggest problem was that I really didn't care all that much. I should have probably just put it down earlier, because it wasn't the case that I was hating what I was reading or that I consider it to be bad quality. It's just that it left me kind of indifferent. And so while I did finish it, I at no point in time really wanted to like continue on with it. It was just the book that I would pick up in the morning and try to read one chapter of so that I could finish it in a decent amount of time. So I gotta say that this is a book that I cannot recommend, because I felt like zero emotion towards this book. And this is the second book by Nick Hornby that I've read, and I definitely enjoyed the first one a lot more than I did this one. It also had a trope that I like more. It had like the stranger stuck in an elevator trope, which I kind of enjoy a lot more. But even then, I just thought it was good, but it's nothing that stood out to me compared to all the other books that I read. So I think I'm just gonna have to give up on my Nick Hornby from now on. Next disappointing read for the month of April would be Howl's Moving Castle by Diana Wynne Jones. So I knew going into this that I needed to tread carefully, I guess, because I knew a whole lot of people have difficulties with this book. I knew a whole lot of people have difficulties getting through this book. And I definitely did not. I will definitely say that I enjoyed my time with this book. I listened to it on audiobook, so maybe that's also a difference, of course. But, you know, you can fight through it. It is an easy writing style. It is easy to get through. However, the big problem with this one is that it just made me want to watch the movie. I had more interest in rewatching the movie every single time I picked this book up than in actually continuing reading the story. I think the big problem is with reading a Studio Ghibli adaptation is that the story of that movie is so blended with the cinematography of Studio Ghibli, with the beautiful animation of those movies, that I'm just always gonna miss that when I'm reading the story. So with this one, it's definitely one that if I had never seen the movie, I could enjoy, but I just love the movie too much, I guess, for this one. But that isn't exactly true, because I love the movie Jurassic Park and I loved the book version. So I cannot fully point out what the problem was with reading this one, but something was missing. Something didn't click for me with this read. And so as a consequence, I'm also unhauling a book, because if you watch my TBR, you might know that I also have the third book within this series. So House of Many Ways, I do not have the second book for some reason. And so I'm unhauling this one because I've decided that I don't have enough of an interest in continuing on with this series to want to pick up the second one and only then get around to the third one. So I'm just getting rid of both of these now. And then the final book for the month is The Well of Ascension by Brandon Sanderson. So this is the second book in Mistborn Era 1. So Mistborn Era 1 is basically my favorite fantasy of all times. It has been that for a very long time. Reading Stormlight Archive has made me think maybe Stormlight Archive is my favorite one. But I actually think that I'm gonna hold off on Stormlight Archive and continue saying that Mistborn Era 1 is my favorite. I still need to reread the third book, of course. But there is just something about Mistborn Era 1. And the fact that it's also a little bit small in scope for some reason also helps me. I think I like epic fantasy, but I do also very much appreciate this type of scale of story. And definitely don't get me wrong there, this is not a small story in scale, and I won't be able to fully judge Stormlight Archive until at least the first 5 books have been completed and I can see the way in which that story has unfolded across the 5 books. Because with Final Empire, the more that I'm reading it, the more that I'm reading Mistborn Era 1, the more that I'm in awe of the way in which Brandon Sanderson has plotted this out. So Mistborn Era 1 centers around the magic system in which you can ingest metals in order to access magical powers. People either have access to none, they have access to one and then they are Mistings, or they have access to all of them and then they are Mistborn. Our protagonist Finn is one of these Mistborns, however she's not aware of this at the beginning of the story. And so she is recruited into this sort of thieving crew who are banding together in order to overthrow the Final Empire. I cannot say much about The Well of Ascension because so much has gone down in the first book that I would only be spoiling the first book if I mentioned anything about what is taking place within the second book. But I will say that a lot of people have a little bit more difficulties with The Well of Ascension. It is a lot less plot-centered than The Final Empire was. A whole lot less goes down. I think most people who are kind of frustrated with Well of Ascension kind of say, like, it's 600 pages of nothing happening and then like 150 pages of a whole lot of things happening. Sanderson is quite known for that. It's called his sort of like Sanderlange. That's sort of a way in which he builds the story and then just goes in like peaks. It's kind of like he's building all these building blocks and then at the end they all come tumbling down in one big Sanderlange, and then you see that all of that work he put into those first 600 pages, it was needed in order to get to that big momentum at the end of the book. And that is a story structure that I absolutely enjoy, but I just also really love the slow pacing of the first 600 pages. At times I also get frustrated with that. At times I'm also like, but I want this or that to take that. I want to see where it's going. But I kind of like that sort of suspenseful state as well. This one is very different in tone from the first one as well. It is a little bit of a different subgenre of fantasy compared to the first one. And so if you don't like this subgenre, then there's more potential for you not to like this one, or not to like it as much as you like the first one. So I would definitely say, if you've loved The Final Empire and you're struggling with this one, I will say most people then absolutely fall in love with the third one. If I'm checking my review for The Well of Ascension, I can see a whole lot of excitement the first time I read this. And I was actually a little bit less excited after having finished The Hero of Ages. So I'm very interested to dive into The Hero of Ages now. Absolutely enjoyed Well of Ascension. There's a plot development at the end that I am not a huge fan of, but I already knew it was there, and I think I did like it the first time I read it. So with that in mind, it was also quite okay for me to reread it and to embrace that that is the way in which Brandon Sanderson decided to go with this one. But so yeah, very happy about this reread and so desperate to continue on now. Hero of Ages, I don't know whether I want to put it at the beginning of the month or not. In any case, my May TBR has like a few new releases on there that I don't physically own yet, so there's a possibility for me to dive into Hero of Ages earlier next month than I did with Well of Ascension, which I basically left as the last book on my TBR. But so yeah, that means the month of April was a very mixed bag. I mean, my initial reaction about my reading month is like, it was an amazing reading month, I loved all of it. But then when I look at what I've actually read, it's really split down the middle. I have 3 5-star reads. I absolutely enjoyed Well of Ascension, Memory of Souls, and Master of Sorrows. These are all 5-star reads. I absolutely completely enjoyed them. And the good thing is that those are also the biggest books on my TBR. So the most of the pages that I read within the month of April definitely went to books that I've highly enjoyed. But all the rest, every single other book that I read was either disappointing, so-so, or excruciating, and I had to put it down. It was a little bit of a weird month in that sense, I guess. So onwards and upwards, I hope, because the month of May has a TBR that I'm so excited about. So if you haven't checked out that video, I would just encourage you guys, go check out my reading plans for the month of May. This is the final day of April, and I have finished all of my reading that I scheduled to do this month, and so I'm diving into that TBR right now. So yeah, hope you guys enjoyed this video, and I hope to see you guys for a future one. Bye!